of Judea and say, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. This is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. I want to talk this morning from this sermonic line, taking from this third verse within this third chapter of the Gospel according to Matthew. Let's talk about, let's teach, let's preach just for the next few moments as the Spirit shall continue to allow us to share for this devotional message. Crying in the wilderness. Crying in the wilderness. Crying in the wilderness. Let the words of my mouth, let the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Thank you, God, for being our strength and our redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Crying in the wilderness. Whenever you call a service provider to provide service for you, the expectation of both parties, the provider as well as the client, is that the service will be provided and compensation will be given for that service. Whenever you call a plumber to fix your kitchen sink, the expectation is that the plumber is going to fix your pipes and you're going to pay the plumber for servicing what you need.
Yeah.
Whenever you call a carpenter to your home to tear up your basement after it has flooded, the expectation is that your basement will be serviced and you will compensate the carpenter for the service that he or she has given unto you.
Yeah.
Are you with me this morning?
Yeah.
I contend that whenever you call a service provider, it is our observation. It is something that we naturally do, something that we naturally would do. We would render compensation unto a provider after they have rendered unto us some service that we have called for.
Yeah.
But however, never in all of my life would I have thought that the children of God would begin to treat God as if we were providing him some service.
Come on, Pastor.
I've made some observations around the land, and my observations have led me to see that many people of God have began to treat God as if he has called us for some service.
Yeah, yeah.
And as if we should be compensating, or as if he should be compensating us.
Yeah.
As though we are providing him with something.
All right.
I've seen it all around the land, and I've been seeing it lately, and I see it here, my brothers and my sisters, even in this city, even in this state, even all around us, where we have began to treat God.
Yes, sir.
As if he done picked up the phone and called us to come to heaven.
Come on, Pastor, preach.
And treat something in heaven. And as we are sitting here waiting for him to render us our pay.
Yes, sir.
As though he owes us.
I admit,
my brothers and my sisters, that we are living in an age where people have began to, here it is, put stipulations on their service unto God.
All right.
Yes, my brothers and sisters, we're living in a day and time where people will not render their due diligence unto our Savior unless their stipulations have been met.
Come on,
Pastor. See it all the time that preachers won't come to your pulpit unless they receive a certain honor.
Come on.
We see it all the time that when people won't come into the house of God unless the temperature is right. We see it all the time that people won't give their service unto our great redeemer without being met with some
right.
For rendering your service unto God.
Yeah.
Here we find in this third chapter of Matthew, John the Baptist is one who is raised on the time of the Lord Jesus Christ, who Matthew testifies, finds himself preaching, yes, telling the truth about God, sharing the gospel narrative in the wilderness of Judea.
Yeah.
The Bible says that he is preaching the good news in the wilderness.
Yeah.
Telling everybody about a man named Jesus in the wilderness.
Yeah.
Sharing one message in the wilderness of Judea.
Yeah.
That you ought to repent and prepare the way for the coming Messiah.
Yeah.
Matthew says that this is the one who the prophet Isaiah has spoken about.
Yeah.
That shall come before the great king and is preaching the good news in the wilderness.
Yes, sir.
One who he says is crying in the wilderness.
Yeah.
In other words, we find John the Baptist who is preaching, yes, my brothers and sisters, hurling the gospel of Jesus Christ, telling the truth on Jesus, setting the story about how our Savior came from glory.
Yeah.
However, he's not in a pulpit. However, he's not in a synagogue. However, he's not standing with a microphone in his hand. He's not standing in a temple. He has no pew in front of him. He has no organ to back him up. He has no speakers so that the people can hear him. He has no phones sharing his message all on social media.
All right.
No, he has no people putting up flyers talking about John the Baptist is coming. No, he's standing in the middle of no man's land and he's preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Yes, sir.
He's standing in the middle of the wilderness, desert land, uncharted territory, unclaimed property, an area where people don't dwell, and he decides to go there to preach. No, you don't. 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 We tend to act like our service unto God is secular occupations. Oh, man, I promise y'all, I'm going to move a little further right along through here. But we tend to act like our service unto God is an occupation. We tend to act like our service unto God is a 9-to-5. We tend to act like our service unto God is something that we should be getting compensated for.
Truth is, my brothers and my sisters,
that's because of you. That the wilderness of Judea, Elder Brown, is a place where people who weren't accepted went. Theologians suggest that the wilderness of Judea was not a cozy place where people of the upper echelon would spend their time. The only time you saw kings in the wilderness of Judea is if they were journeying through the wilderness, trying to make their way to the other side. But the people you would find in the wilderness are people who were discounted, people who were discredited, people who had no place to go. The wilderness of Judea, many would contend, was a place where the homeless felt themselves. Was a place where people who didn't care about nothing and didn't have no family and had nobody to care for them spent their time in the wilderness. And I suggest something to you, my brothers and my sisters, that even in the wilderness, where you can get it somewhere off here. We must stop sharing the truth about Jesus.
Yeah.
Somewhere off here, we must stop telling the gospel about our God. But here it is, I can tell you that the message is still the same. As much as we try to switch our method, as much as we try to twist and turn the method, as much as we try to add to the method, the message should never change. The message is still, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. John the Baptist knew without shadow of doubt that it doesn't matter how many ways I say it, the premise of what I'm saying is that you got to get yourself together because Jesus is on his way. And I submit unto you, my brothers and my sisters, that if you want to learn to cry out in the wilderness, you got to make sure you're clear about your message. That you do got to make sure you are clear about your message. You got to make sure you are clear about your message. You got to make sure you are clear about your message. How can I understand what you are saying when you don't even know what you're saying? How can we?